Hello there. Welcome back to the booth here at Pro Tour Eldritch Moon. Marshall Sutcliffe, and I'm joined now by Luis Scott Vargas. Luis, thank you so much for jumping right out of your match and right into the booth here. We certainly appreciate it.
No problem. I didn't
How you feel?
Miss,
you all right?
miss our appointment.
So yeah. He's always on time. So, second semifinal match is lined up for you here. We've got Sam Pardee versus Lukas Blohon playing a best of five to see who gets to fight Owen Turtenwald in the finals. Let's head down to the feature match area. Hello and welcome to coverage of Pro Tour Eldritch Moon. I'm Marshall Sutcliffe in the booth with Hall of Famer Luis Scott Vargas, and we're set for semifinal number two. The winner of this match is going to play Owen Turtenwald for the trophy. On the left side, we've got Sam Pardee. Take a look at Sam here from the United States. As he finds himself in the top eight, facing down Lukas Blohon from the Czech Republic. This is his second Pro Tour top eight. And let's get underway. Luis, the matchup. Let's talk about this. We've got black-green Delirium for Pardee versus white-black Control from Blohon.
Lukas is playing a deck that we did not expect quite as many to show up at or at this tournament because the card Emrakul is very good against the black-white deck. The black-white deck just has a ton of spells it can wreak havoc on its own cards with. So Sam and Lukas, I think, both have identified Emrakul as the most important card in the matchup.
Yeah, they have. In fact, I got a chance to talk to their testing teams and even to Lukas directly before the match. And yes, they did say that. They said that it was going to be really important to the late game, as Emrakul is just bigger and better than what Lukas has going on in the late game. Lukas also noted that he doesn't think he's a favorite in the matchup, though. He's not quite sure how bad it is for him. And that he says that his Lilianas aren't going to be as good as Sam's Lilianas. They both have the card in their deck. He thinks that Sam is going to be able to minus Liliana to get back a bunch of value creatures and grind, where Lilianas for Lukas, the main plan here is to ultimate.
Lilianas ultimate is a very real thing, and Lukas is playing her as a removal spell splash ultimate. Sam has basically no targets for the removal aspect, and Lukas doesn't have any creatures to get back. I mean, he's just got a couple Avacyns and some Kalidas, so I don't think you're going to end up seeing these Lilianas much in post-board games.
Sam, on the other hand, can minus Liliana and get back any number of creatures from his graveyard. Tireless Trackers, Den Protectors later on.
Grim Flayers,
which he's already got in the graveyard here, as you can see. He's transgressed the mine now for Blohon. Is he going to take a look at Sam Pardee's hand and see what he's working with?
Sam's hand is not what you'd want in this matchup, especially since he's only got the one threat, just the one Ishkana. So if Lukas decides to take Ishkana, which, of course, transgress exiles, so Sam's future Lilianas won't get her back, then Sam's left with three removal spells and no way to draw cards. So, yes, Sam can't be super thrilled about this turn of events. Liliana might legitimately ultimate this game.
Blohon, also now aware of the two copies of Grasp of Darkness, is going to be able to play around those. You can see the Kalatas in his hand there.
Yeah, he's a lot less likely to run that out unless he just doesn't care about it getting grasped. If he's got no other play, then it makes some sense, but he is going in with his eyes wide open here.
And he's not even going to bother playing it. He just ticks Liliana up to six. Now, she ultimates at seven. We're just two turns away here if Sam can't find some pressure.
Yeah, and Sam's got three Ruinous Paths in his deck, and that's the card he's going to want to draw right now, since if he doesn't find Ruinous Path next turn, Liliana starts slowly, you know, assembling the zombie horde. First two, then four, then six, and
yeah.
So on.
Start slow, finishes quite quickly. We've seen it a few times. Here's Languish from Blohon just to take down the Den Protector. Sam's going to get to activate it before it goes away, but is he going to find anything that actually matters is the question.
He can get back the Traverse the Ovenwald, and then later, once he gets Delirium, it becomes more of a card. But yeah, right now it's not doing a ton for him.
Pardee finds another miserable card for him, an ultimate prize off the top.
It's funny, just the composition of removal that Sam drew this game, they're all pretty interchangeable, except Ruinous Path, the one he actually wants, and he's drawn all grasps and ultimate prizes. So we're going to see a lot of that in the game one. You know, games one and two are no sideboarded, where both players just have a ton of excess removal they don't want.
And there we go. Liliana Emblem is online.
And so now Lukas is by by default winning this game. He just needs to make sure nothing crazy happens. And even Emrakul can't actually remove the emblem. That's why Liliana was added to the to the Gatewatch, I assume.
Indeed.
I hope we get to see a double Liliana emblem. Now that would be something. Oh, one turn too late. There's the Ruinous
Path. Oh, what heartbreak for Sam. I mean, does he have any way to race the number of zombies that are coming in? There's just no way, right? He can keep them at bay for a while.
Well, a fast Emrakul, you can play Emrakul, maybe make Lucas waste a few cards, attack for 13, and then languish all the zombies away, and then be a turn away from winning. But Lucas has his own Ruinous Path that if he draws Obnixilus also, these are cards that can kill Emrakul. So, and Sam's going to need two hits, not just one.
Yeah, now he's got that Obnixilus on the battlefield already.
Sam might just also lose to the Obnixilus here, even if Liliana wasn't enough.
So 2 plus the number of zombies you control means 4 for Blohon as he passes a turn back. And, yeah, Sam Pardee sitting here facing down now a Planeswalker on 6 loyalty, a Planeswalker emblem, and 6 creatures on the battlefield plus a creature land. It's going to be really hard for him to find his way out of this mess. There's Languish to reset, though. That does buy him a little bit of time.
And Sam did draw a second Ruinous Path, so at some point he's going to be able to kill the Obnixilus as well. But again, these Ruinous Paths, they showed up a little too late for Sam.
Yeah, his library has not been kind to him with that timing.
You're going to see this out of both decks. They're both playing like black-based control decks that have a lot of removal and not a ton of ways to draw cards compared to traditional control decks we've seen, you know, in other eras of Magic. So if you draw the wrong mix of removal spells, you can end up in a pretty tough spot.
Sam is doing what he can do to keep that zombie horde from growing out of control. He uses one of his Grasp of Darknesses just to take down a token.
Yeah, but when you're grasping at tokens, you're grasping at straws
as well. Yeah, this isn't going to end well for Pardee, though. He is going to fight the fight. This is the semifinals, after all.
Sam trying to avoid the fate of getting Liliana plus Obnixilus ultimated.
Which he does.
He wasn't too far away. All right.
Now, this is a line of play that you describe where if Sam is going to find his way out of this mess, it's going to be through Emrakul. So the question is, can he cast Emrakul? Looks like the players were doing a count there to see how close he actually was. He's got 7 lands on the battlefield.
So it looks like Sam's got exact Delirium, so 4 different types right now. So Emrakul is going to cost 9.
So he's 2 lands away currently. Or some Delirium.
But one of the features of the black-green deck is compared to something like the Temur Emerge deck, it's much less aggressive at getting Delirium and adding card types to its graveyard. We just unfortunately saw Owen Turtenwald rack up 5 or 6 different types by turn 3 or 4 thanks to Vessels of Nascency and Gather the Pack, cards like that. Sam's not really playing those cards. He's just more naturally getting Delirium as the game goes long.
Ultimate Price kills a zombie, but the Shambling Vent is still going to get in. And there's Kalatas as well. Blohon just has to be saying, I've had this emblem for like 3 or 4 turns here. But
yeah,
I only have 2 zombies. Why are we still playing this game?
But think about it this way. Sam's using cards out of his hand to kill these zombies, sometimes at a 1-for-1, like 1 card for 1 zombie. And Lucas is just getting that for free, plus all the rest of the cards he's drawing.
And this is Liliana, immediately -2. That's going to mill the top 2 cards of his library, and then he can grab a creature from his graveyard and put it in his hand.
Yeah, he's got Gloomflayer and Sylvan Advocate, which are both serviceable blockers, but the Ishkana got exiled to Transgress, so yeah. Unfortunately for Sam, not an option.
Well, at least he found it targets for all that spot removal. He's trying to buy enough time to get to Emrakul here.
And if Lucas kills Liliana, that actually adds essentially a mana to Emrakul's cost, or reduces the Emrakul's cost by a mana. So Lucas has incentive to not necessarily go after Liliana.
She's not doing much on 1 loyalty anyway, right? Just shrinking down a zombie or another creature.
And Sam's a turn away from being able to actually put her in the graveyard himself, because he can +1 her up to 2, and then next turn -2 her. But Lucas might be able to take Sam down by then. It's going to be close. The problem for Sam is that I think that it's highly likely that Sam does eventually get to resolve an Emrakul this game. I don't think that's
Lucas did attack Liliana here.
All right, so Lucas is not super worried about that. And the problem is, even if Sam does resolve an Emrakul, that doesn't just automatically win the game.
No, not at all. fact, if it does win the game, we may need to have Ian Duke from R&D come in here and explain why the zombie horde was not victorious. No, it's my guess that it probably will be. Okay, traverse Ulvenwald here for Pardee.
And again, he is delirious, so he can get...
It's going to be Ishkana. He's going to make some spiders thanks to Delirium.
It's gonna buy Sam some time, at least another turn here, but...
Yeah, at this like point, one turn.
At this point, Liliana's making 8 additional zombies.
And, you know, you kind of jokingly said it before, but the other Liliana is going up to to 7 here as well.
It really is Emrakul vs. the world here, and it's unclear whether Emrakul is going to have enough of an influence to take all that down.
Seen a lot of Emrakul in the feature match area on the weekend. Clearly one of the better cards in Standard right off the bat.
I played against Emrakul every single round but one in this tournament, including the top 8.
Oh, my goodness. So that was a combination of Grasp of Darkness plus Liliana to take down Ishkana and force a lot of chump blocks. Does he even have enough?
Yeah, Sam can go to 2 here if he chump blocks everything. Yeah.
So he's at 2. Blohon is going to jump up to 22. Look at all the zombies.
Kaboom.
And there we go. Emrakul has hit the battlefield. Let's see if it's enough.
Well, the language does mean that Sam's going to get to wipe the board. Linvala is going to make an ill-advised attack right into Emrakul. And other than that...
He can minus Liliana and miss.
He can minus Liliana and miss, and he can then attack Liliana with his Emrakul next turn, or just attack Lukas directly. But he cannot stop Lukas from getting 2 zombies. So basically what Sam needs to have happen is figure out a way to not die on his next turn to get 2 attacks in with Emrakul. And if Sam had a second Emrakul, this would work out. But he needs something... Because the problem is the two zombies are going to be able to attack Sam immediately, so I don't see a way out of this.
Now, Sam does play 3 copies of Languish. It's not enough, right? He still has to be able to survive the immediate next turn. Yeah,
right,
that's
because
gonna do it.
Sam takes the Emrakul turn, eventually has to say go. Liliana makes 2 zombies. Lukas just attacks both
and
zombies.
Those are just
and Sam's at 2.
Yep. All right, that's going to do it for our first game. Lukas Blohon, thanks to the Liliana emblem, takes down Sam Pardee. We'll be right back after these messages.
Test drive the top Standard decks from this Pro Tour in the Pro Tour Gauntlet, beginning this Wednesday on Magic Online. For more information, visit mtgo.com. Ready to take your game to the next level and start on the path to the Pro Tour? Rise to the challenge and test your skills at a local preliminary Pro Tour qualifier. To find an event near you, visit magic.wizards.com/pptq.
And welcome back to the feature match area here in Sydney, Australia for Pro Tour Eldritch Moon. Luis, while we have a minute, while the players are shuffling up and getting ready to play in their next game, I did want to check in with you about your top 8. You know, you're very kind and you'll jump right in right after playing in your top 8 match. But you know, how did things go from your perspective?
I lost a tough match to Owen. We ended up going to 5 games and we had... really close games 4 and 5. I actually thought I was losing game 4 almost the entire time. But Emrakul plus Kozak's return wiped everything I had out, except I basically then got to draw and then use Recruiter twice to find the last Reflector Mage to maybe win the game. Wasn't able to do that. And then game 5, I kept a hand with 2 lands that come to play tapped. All the spells I wanted, just the 2 lands. I missed my 3rd land drop, but as it turns out, Owen had turn 1 Gnarlwood Dryad, turn 2 Gnarlwood Dryad plus Vessel of Nascency, and then turn 3 they both had Delirium. So they were both 3-3 death touches, and that really just put me on the back foot. Owen was able to get me down to something like 10, and then Wretched Griff got me to 1, and eventually he finished me off with Helder Deep Fiend. So
great job, Luis. I know you had, you know, everybody in the Twitch chat was cheering for you there, and... congrats on 3 Pro Tour top 8s in a row, too. Incredible
really
feat. It's just incredible.
I would have loved to take one down, not going to lie. But honestly, if I was going to lose to anyone, losing to Owen is pretty high on my list of people I'd love to see win a Pro Tour. I think that Owen has been the best player and is very much due to have some of that kind of success like that. Though, of course, he has 2 Pro Tour top 8s this year. So.
Yeah, yep. Okay, looks like we're underway here. For the second game of our second semifinal between Sam Pardee of the United States, Lukas Blohon from the Czech Republic. I'll remind you that this is not a sideboarded game. That will happen after this. First two games are pre-sideboard here in the top eight.
And it's funny because both players get to board out a ton of dead removal. I believe that it favors Lukas more post-board because he gets to get infinite obliteration for Emrakul, which is a key play in this format. Yeah, both of these guys, you see Sam there and then facing against Lukas. Actually, both former teams of mine at different times in my Magic playing career. So it's pretty awesome seeing them both in the top eight here.
Yeah, Sam eventually landed on face-to-face games team, and Lukas is testing with Team Eureka.
Yeah, Lukas's first top eight at Pro Tour Hawaii in 2012 was actually as a member of Team Channel Fireball. He played a Birthing Pod deck to the top eight there. And, of course, as I'm sure you've told the viewers, got ninth at the last Pro Tour. So this has been a very good year for him.
Yeah, he's going to be platinum going into next year. A fantastic year for Lukas. I was really happy to see him in the top eight here, too, because it gets him some camera time. Relatively quiet platinum year, but bang, there's a top eight.
I'm sure we'll see more from Lukas in the future.
And here's a Grimflayer from Pardee, an interesting card in his list.
Grimflayer is a very, very powerful card.
Did you guys test it?
We did. We had a list very similar to the list that Face2Face played here, and we liked Grimflayer a lot. We thought that was one of the biggest reasons to play this black-green deck.
I had a chance to chat with Mike Sigrist about it, and he said the team was a little divided about how they felt about Grimflayer specifically, but him and Sam really liked the card a lot.
Well, the drawback, especially in a deck like this, is it's a card that dies to your own languishes. It's a removal target. Like, imagine if Sam drew it game one, Lukas would just killed it.
Yeah.
So playing creatures in a deck that's pretty controlish has that drawback, and as you see, actually, a language wiped out the Grimflayer and the Tireless Tracker.
Indeed.
But the effect of Grimflayer is so powerful. It's just if it's a 2-mana 4/4 that increases your draw step and gets you to Delirium, I mean, that's just insane. So the upside, I think, is worth it, and that's why they settled on playing it.
We'll talk about if those are going to be still in the deck post-sideboard when we get to that point in the match right now. We've hit the midsection of the game with the same problem that Sam had before, Liliana.
Yeah, Sam has a few more draw options here because of the two clues he got off the Tireless Tracker plus Evolving Wilds. So he's going to get to see more cards, but yeah, it's the same problem. There's a Liliana on five. Sam doesn't really have a way to pressure it. At some point, he might be able to attack with his Hissing Quagmire, but that's really not a winning proposition, especially if Lukas just leaves mana untapped and just casts one of his removal spells. Also, Lukas has three copies of Archangel Avacyn in his deck. If you attack Hissing Quagmire into an Archangel Avacyn, that it does not end well for you. And it looks like Sam's one short of Delirium for that Grimflayer, but Lukas can't feel good about plussing Liliana and hoping Sam doesn't get to Delirium, because Sam does have ways to get there.
So he's going to read the bones here. Is he looking for a removal spell for the Flayer?
I think that's pretty high on his list. I guess it is worth noting that Sam is missing Instant and for Delirium, and Instant is not easy for him to get without casting a removal spell, with the only target right now being Grimflayer. So it's possible Lukas can float a turn without Sam hitting Delirium.
Blohon is thinking about what to do with his Read the Bones here.
Read the Bones is a really, really important card for this black-white deck.
Well, he's going to keep both of them.
Oh, it's just the black divination.
Indeed. Not great news for Sam Pardee. It's like an Ishkanah Graph Widow off the top there for Sam.
Yeah, to go with his three Grasps of Darkness, which would give him Delirium, but again, no targets. I would not advise you to Grasp of Darkness your own Grimflayer to get Delirium.
You can't have both. These draws from Pardee. He just seems to be drawing all of his spot removal spells. He is going to get those out of his library as quickly as possible when it comes to sideboarding.
Yeah, and one of the things you see about matchups like this is whoever draws more removal in the pre-board games just ends up being in such a bad spot, because your deck is like action cards and dead removal, and Sam's just drawn three or four dead removal spells. Granted, Lukas has also, but Lukas always has a Planeswalker to pair with them.
Planeswalkers, we just got upgraded. Now there's Sorin Grim Nemesis here as well.
Oh, wow.
And interestingly, Lukas is just going to plus. He just feels pretty confident that Sam's not going to be able to get to Delirium here.
Sam has the unenviable choice here of activate a Hissing Quagmire, grasp it, attack Liliana for two if he really wants to keep her off ultimate. He could also just attack with the Hissing Quagmire, but the other play sets him up in future turns for
Delirium. With
for, a 4-4
Delirium. And Delirium, yeah, okay.
Though either one is not very appealing. You can go.
It looks like he's just decided to attack with the Hissing Quagmire, knocking Liliana from 7, which is where she was about to ultimate again, down to 5.
Yeah, but Lucas still has to feel great here. He's just, you know, using Sorin every turn, like using Liliana every turn. Once the Planeswalkers start rolling, it's again really hard to come back.
Especially if you're forcing Sam to tap virtually all of his mana every turn just to keep an ultimate from happening here.
And Sam's missing land drops. He has 5 lands in play. Lucas is about to have 7 lands in play. So Lucas is ahead on basically all the metrics you would look at in a control versus control matchup. One of the edges Lucas does have is that with his 3 copies of Read the Bones, he actually has legit card draw, whereas Sam has Traverse the Ovenwald, but if you don't hit Delirium and you see he's played Traverse this game without it, it ends up being more like an extra land than an actual spell.
Mm. By the way, Blohon has found a copy of Grasp of Darkness. Now, Pardee is not obliged to attack Liliana this turn to keep her off of ultimate, so he may just develop his board here. All right, that's a little more like it.
Yeah, except Sam does not have the 6 lands, so those Sylvan Advocates are going to be 2/3s. And Lucas is probably just looking at the Languish in his hand and thinking about how this next turn is going to be a good one. It's also possible, though, Lucas has enough spot removal that he maybe just strings together a couple spot removal spells this turn. Oh, looks like he does not actually have the Languish.
Yeah, we're showing Sam with the Languish here.
So given that Lucas doesn't have Languish, yeah, Grasp end of turn makes sense.
He's found a second copy of Obnixilus. This could be his 3rd Planeswalker on the battlefield here.
After how many Planeswalkers in play do you just get to declare victory?
I would say 2. The 3rd one, you're just showing off.
Yeah, Sam is pretty outnumbered here. Lucas is essentially taking 2.5 turns to Sam's turn.
Yeah, and what's going to happen is he's now going to cast Obnixilus to kill the Grimflayer, and then he's going to plus Liliana to put her at ultimate range again next turn.
There's a chance Sam ends up, or Lucas ends up wanting to just leave all his mana up because with the assumption that the plus on Liliana takes care of the Grimflayer, because then he's got Archangel Avacyn and Grasp and Shambling Vent to protect.
Okay.
To protect Liliana, because I think Lucas has assessed that if he ultimates Liliana again, that just gives him a fairly rapid path to victory before Sam's able to resolve an Emrakul.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense, and it looks like he's moving in on that plan, and this is not going to work out well for Sam Pardee. Though it is get a little bit interesting. The Grasp of Darkness can kill one creature, and then he can also just play Archangel Avacyn.
What Sam's really hoping is that Lucas does something like animate Shambling Vent or play an Avacyn, and then Sam gets to grasp it and hit Delirium off for Grimflayer, making it a 4-4, or rather a 2-3, thanks to the Liliana minus.
Is Lucas going to oblige him here?
Well, Lucas...
He could just take 2. Liliana could just take 2 here.
What Lucas could do here is... He could just let that happen. He could activate Shambling Vent, and then if he does that, he'll have enough mana still to play Avacyn if the Shambling Vent dies.
That's interesting.
So I think he's going to use Avacyn as the backup plan because presumably Sam's casting the Grasp before blockers.
Then he would play Avacyn.
Though Sam knows that Lucas has 3 Avacyns, so it looks like Sam might actually let Lucas block here. This is a good play from Sam. Because
this is a really cool sequence.
Because now Lucas gets to block the Quagmire. Sam casts Grasp, and now Lucas gets to play the Avacyn, but Avacyn can't block anymore because we're already past that step. So Avacyn doesn't get to ambush anything. Still, this still ends up pretty good for Lucas. Avacyn's actually going to flip now on Lucas's upkeep.
Yeah. The good news for Sam Pardee is that Liliana does take 2 in that exchange and is not going to ultimate this turn. But Avacyn transforming into Avacyn the Purifier is going to do 3 to him and put up a pretty reasonable clock herself.
Yeah, the bad news is Sam's having to throw all this time and resources to fight Liliana. He's just losing badly to Soren and Avacyn.
Oh, no. There's anguish in making off the top from Soren as well. So now...
Is it flavorful or not flavorful that Sam's the one losing three life off revealing anguish on making? I can't actually tell.
By the way, the combination of Liliana minus and the Avacyn damage takes down Grimflayer there as well. And now we've got triple Planeswalkers and a transformed Mythic Rare.
Lucas
wouldn't
is
trade
kind of running
seats
up
with
the
Sam.
Score
yeah,
at this,
this is Lucas running away with game number two. He's already up a game as well. And I wouldn't be surprised to see Pardee pack it in here in a turn or two.
If Sam was able to find an Emrakul, he could probably get some nice plays going on Lucas's side. Planeswalkers are a huge liability when Emrakul's happening, but the window to do that is closing very, very rapidly here.
Blohon was considering using a Grasp of Darkness to kill Spider, decided against it. By the way, kind of creepy Planeswalker numbers there, too.
Yeah.
Lucas going for the flavor victory here on Innistrad. Let's see if he can finish the game off this turn. One at a time, down go the Spiders.
And then Soren and Obnixilus kill the last two.
Yeah, he's actually just going to kill all four blockers and attack for lethal in the air with Avacyn the Purifier. Lucas Blohon is up pretty quick, 2-0 over Sam Pardee. Wow. All right, Luis, this, of course, means that we are now heading into game three. And game three is when the players are allowed to start sideboarding. So what we did is, well, we got it right from the players. Let's take a listen to what they've got going on for sideboard plans.
All right, Sam Pardee, tell me what's going to happen games three and forward after you sideboard for this match.
So the plan is I'm going to take out some removal because particularly the other three copies of Languish in my main deck, they're not doing a lot for me. I want the Dark Petitions, Duresses, Transgress, and Seasons Past. Basically, I just want to be a controlling deck and try to out-control him. I want to, and then Seasons Past and do it all over again. Just make sure I don't die is sort of my plan. And eventually my cards, I think, will draw me more cards than his cards will draw him cards. And eventually I'll just end up with more cards, and then you win.
Okay, good games the rest of the way here in the top eight. All right, Lucas, you've already made extensive use of your sideboard in this top eight. What's the plan for games three, four, and potentially five in the semifinals?
So the cards that I'm bringing for sure are four Gideons. That's just the card that kills them very quickly if they don't do anything about it, so that's great. One Thrumskrizz of the Mind, because it can take even creatures from their hand. Some number of Duresses, I'm not exactly sure if three or four, because they don't have that many spells, and I don't want to draw multiples if they don't have any. And then Anguish on my king. And then I'm not sure if I want Infinite Obliteration or not, because they have just one Emrakul, and I'm not sure if it's worth it yet, so we'll have to figure that out.
How do you make room for all that? What comes out?
Well, some number of removal spells, then Liliana's, because they aren't that great. They're mainly for the plus ability, but they have Renew's Path, so they can just kill it when it has 6 loyalty or something like that. So it just takes a lot of time for that. Some number of Languishes, Hallowed Moonlights, maybe Linvala the Preserver, and maybe some number like one Avacyn, one Ultimate Prize, something like that.
Okay, well, good games the rest of the way here in the top eight. Lucas Blohon.
And welcome back to the feature match area here in Sydney, Australia. We're working our way down the stretch of the tournament here. Sunday, the top eight. We're on our second semifinal match. We've already got one finalist. That would be Owen Turtenwald. He will be doing some practicing.
Panning in on the rat there.
The O-Rat, indeed, is waiting in the finals. And, well, if you're going by the numbers, he's likely to play against Lucas Blohon here, but I wouldn't tell that to Sam Pardee. He just needs to rattle off three in a row here to put himself in the finals against his countryman.
Well, Lucas was down 0-2 in his quarterfinal match, so
there you go.
He has seen it happen.
Also, things are going to change dramatically post-sideboard here. We did see some real liabilities in hand there for Sam Pardee with so much spot removal in game one and a decent number of it in game two that he just couldn't point at anything. And he's going to be able to take all those cards out.
An interesting feature of the black control mirror is game one, a lot of it's dictated by, who draws too much dead removal. Games two and three, or rather, games three, four, and potentially five, they don't have very many dead cards because everyone swapped out the removal for just action. So the games are, you're going to see a lot fewer turns of like, we each have three cards we don't really want to cast, and a lot more back and forth.
You've known Sam for a while, right?
I have. He's from Northern California as well, which is where I grew up and lived for many years. And like I said, we tested when Team Channel Fireball and Team Face to Face tested together, and I've just known him from like local events. I was a frequent customer of the bakery his mom works at.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
Did she hook you up?
She once asked if I knew her son because I was wearing a Channel Fireball sweatshirt, and I'm like. Probably not, but who is it? She's like, oh, Sam Pardee. I'm like, no, I know him.
Yeah. Know him very well, in fact. All right, we're underway here in the third game. This is a big one.
Yeah.
If Lukas wins this game, he's into the finals, and Sam really needs to start riding the ship here and putting up some W's if he's going to give Lukas a run here in our second semifinal match. So let's see how things play out in the early stages of this third game. A duress to start things off for Pardee.
Duress is another interesting one in these matchups. We even heard Lukas say during sideboarding, I don't want to board in too many duresses because if you draw them in the mid to late game, it just ends up missing. It's great on turn one. You get your option of here, four different cards. You have information about your opponent's game plan. Drawing dead discard spells in the middle of the game when your opponent's just operating on no cards in hand is just the worst. So it's balancing how many you get to play is very important.
Yeah, Lukas, of course, out of his list, he's got four duress in the sideboard that he could bring in if he wanted, but he's also got two Transgress the Mind in his main deck as well, so there is a balance to be struck.
And as Sam, of course, complicates things by the black-green deck having a lot of creatures. Sometimes you'll cast Duress on Sam when he has four cards in hand, he'll have two land and two creatures, and you will not feel smart.
Speaking of creatures, here's Nissa Vastwood Seer for Sam Pardee, the first creature to hit the battlefield. He's going to go grab a swamp. Solid choice of swamps there from Pardee as well.
Yeah.
Went unhinged. And that is Transgress from Lukas Blohon here. Can't quite see.
Seeing the forest from Nissa and then the couple removal spells here.
Looks like a Transgress of Mind for Pardee there as well.
Yeah, Transgress, not good at stealing duress or other transgresses.
Exactly. So he whiffed. He didn't get anything, did he?
And yep, that's part of the risk is that these spells are conditional, and now Lukas is just down a card. And being down a card post-board is a lot different than game one. Game one, you're just going to draw some dead cards. Post-board, you don't really have very many dead cards to draw, so being down a card is very impactful.
Obnixilis is going to get transgressed away, though, from the other direction, so Sam Pardee is going to take that away from Lukas and attack for two with Nissa. So players are trading resources here in the early stages, though. A nice draw from Lukas Blohon right off the top. Read the bones.
Yeah.
That's what he wanted to see.
Discard does not have protection from top decks.
No.
one way of saying a saying we use frequently.
Wow. He actually saw two lands, scryed them to the bottom, and found two more lands off the top.
And lands are good in control matchups, but Lukas is would not mind seeing a couple less.
He's going to be glad he scryed away those top two. He'd be sitting there drawing lands forever.
Yeah. And in that case, Read the Bones is almost like a draw four, which shows kind of the power of the card.
There's Kalatas off the top for Blohon. Pardee does have a Grasp of Darkness in his hand, so he would certainly welcome Lukas casting a Kalatas here. Sam boarded out some number of spot removal spells, but he couldn't board them all out.
Yeah, not only could these players not board them all out, like Lukas at the very least needs to keep in some just to respect cards like Tireless Tracker, Sylvan Advocate, Grimflayer. Like he can expect Sam to potentially shave some of those numbers because Sam does have to, you know, side a lot of cards in. But if you side out all your removal and Sam just goes Grimflayer, Tireless Tracker, you could end up in a pretty tough spot. That is one of the advantages of being on Sam's side. When you have a bunch of creatures in your deck, and then you get to decide whether you want to sideboard out those creatures, your opponent has to account for the fact that you might leave them in.
Ouch. Lukas Blohon activates his Shambling Vent just to attack this turn, and Sam Pardee uses Grasp on that.
I would feel great about that if I were Sam. Trading a Grasp for a land in a control matchup is awesome.
Wow, especially given that Lukas had to effectively tap out to do that. His whole turn disappeared.
The funny thing is, from Lucas' perspective, that also was a pretty good trade. Lucas just has a lot of lands and does not mind trading one off for a spell.
He's not missing land drops anytime soon.
And at this point, Lucas has to worry about Nissa flipping, becoming the Sage Animist. So since Sam's presumably going to play his seventh land next turn.
So Lucas has Anguished Unmaking. Sam also knows about it.
And Lucas is choosing to use Anguished Unmaking instead of Grasp of Darkness. So one reason to do that is because that makes Lucas safe from Transgress the Mind. Yeah, Tireless Tracker, a great draw for Sam, especially paired with that Evolving Wilds. Even if Lucas kills the Tireless Tracker, Sam's drawn at least one card, potentially two, because Lucas may want to try to kill the Tracker in response to Sam sacrificing Evolving Wilds, but I don't think he's necessarily going to get the opportunity.
Was Lucas worried about Evolving Wilds the previous turn as well with the Nissa there?
Yeah, that's one of the reasons he
also
killed it when he
awkward,
did.
Also pretty awkward, right? Yeah.
So this is a good play by Sam. Kalidus on the stack. Sam sacrificed the Evolving Wilds. So then if Lucas wants to kill the Tireless Tracker in response to Wilds to deny Sam the clue, Lucas does not
get
a zombie.
Okay.
But it looks like Lucas let that all happen, let Kalidus resolve, and then got a zombie.
And on end step, Sam Pardee is going to sacrifice a clue to draw a card, leaving him with just one clue left.
Yeah, and Sam does have Delirium here for future transgresses, I believe. Oh, no, Anguished Unmaking and Kalitas exiled. So actually, Sam is one off. He's got land, instant, sorcery, and no creature.
For future traverses.
Yeah. And keeping track of your opponent's Delirium count is very important during the course of the match, especially with Emrakul, knowing whether your opponent's to turn off of Emrakul or not. Sam is not unhappy trading each Tireless Tracker for a removal spell and drawing two cards off these clues, but Kalitas does make it so every time Lucas casts a spell, he kind of draws a card. He draws a 2-2 zombie after every removal spell, which is pretty good. So Lucas actually might aggro Sam out here.
Yeah, it looks like he's just got kind of a never-ending stream of removal spells. And there's 5 damage. Sam Pardee is going to drop down.
And Lucas has 14. One of his Archangel Avacyns in his hand. So
oh, really?
Lucas is really going to be able to up the pressure next turn. Sam's very close to just dying to a bunch of creatures here. And thanks to Anguished Unmaking and Kalitas, Lucas has successfully kept Sam off Delirium, so these traverses are just not going to get it done.
Oh, what a strange sequence here. Lucas all of a sudden becoming the aggressive player. Sam plays a Grim Flare, but the bad news here is that Avacyn has shown up, and she's just going to pile on a bunch of damage with Kalitas and potentially some zombies. Still no Delirium here for Pardee, right?
Some of those vents might shamble over, too. And Sam's now wishing he had all those dead removal spells from game 1.
Yeah, it is funny how this is panning out for him. It's just like he had all these removal spells in game 1 and no targets, and he took them out, presumably, and now he's getting run over by creatures.
Lucas has to decide whether he wants to play around removal spells, whether he's basically attacking with a Shambling Vent or not, since I believe Lucas drew Ultimate Price, which will not have doesn't currently have a target, but yeah, but could be useful in the future here. So Sam currently, if he blocks Kalitas, he takes 10 and goes to 4. If he blocks one of the zombies, he takes potentially an additional 3 damage if Lucas sacrifices that zombie. So in either case, Sam's in trouble. Also, if he blocks a zombie, Lucas could just let damage happen. And then, or either way, Avacyn actually gets to flip off sacrificing the zombie. So Lucas has very close to lethal here.
He's just going to pass the turn back because Lucas knows how close he is to putting himself in the finals.
Yeah, so Lucas puts Sam to 4 here, gets another zombie, and then has Avacyn that he can flip kind of at will by sacrificing a zombie to Kalitas.
And that puts Sam to a virtual 1?
And Lucas has just 2 Shambling Vents. So even if Sam has like a board sweep of some kind, then Lucas is going to get to you know, attack for the last points of damage with those creature lands.
Well, this has not come together for Sam Pardee in this match against Blohon. He has cruised to victory here, and it looks like he's close to winning the entire match and earning the right to play against Owen Turtenwald. And that's it. Lukas Blohon is our other finalist. Youch.
Wow, that was a very quick 3-0. Most people imagined. My draws are pretty good.
Yeah. You know, when you think about two black-based control decks fighting it out, you think we're going to be in for some long games, and it wasn't that at all.
Well, it turns out that a lot of the good controlling cards in this format are also pretty proactive. Archangel Avacyn, Tireless Tracker, you know, these are cards that reward you for actually putting pressure on your opponent. So even though these are definitely control decks, both of them had pretty substantial amount of threats.
Yeah, I mean, we saw a turn there in that final game where all of a sudden Lukas just had Kalatas plus a bunch of zombie friends and an Avacyn, and you know, Sam's looking down like, well, how am I going to deal with all these cards? And it turned out he couldn't. So that's going to put Lukas Blohon as our second finalist, and we're going to get our players geared up for the finals here shortly. Owen Turtenwald versus Lukas Blohon. So what does the matchup look like here? We've got Teemer Emerge for Turtenwald, and then you saw the black-white deck there from Blohon. So we're going to let the news desk set that stage for us. Let's head back to Richard Hagen.
Thanks very much, Marshall. Wasn't that other guy playing a minute ago?
Yeah, he plays in a breakaway Channel Fireball shirt, so when he loses, he can just rip it off. Nice. He's all suited up, and then he just steps into the booth.
Okay, great stuff. Louis Scott Vargas there. It's great to have him with us. Sad not to see him down on the floor, though. All right, so we've been joined by Brian David Marshall, Pro Tour historian from inside Wizards of the Coast R&D, Ian Duke. Gentlemen, let's review the day so far, and we'll gear up for the final. And before that final, we will reveal all 24 slots at the World Championship coming up at PAX in just a few short weeks. So let's get to it. Let's take a look at our bracket. We'll show you the eight players that came in first thing this morning. And we began down at the bottom of our bracket with a real heavyweight clash. It was Louis Scott Vargas against Reed Duke. BDM, what happened?
Louis Scott Vargas banted Reed Duke. He just came out of the gates pretty quick. Took it in three straight games. A couple of very typical aggro games from Bank Company, and then a third grindy game where he was able to, you know, bounce some pretty impressive creatures in Dragonlord Otarka and beat an Emrakul.
Staying at the bottom half of the bracket, we played them at the same time. Owen Turtenwald was up against Yuta Takahashi, the other Bank Company deck in the top eight, and Owen was unveiling the first of the Teemer Emerge decks in our top eight. Well, it was 3-1 to Owen Turtenwald. He advanced, and it was pretty comfortable because he had some mana issues in the one game that he lost. So we went to the top half of the bracket. That saw Sam Pardee against Andrew Brown. This was Black-Green Delirium against Teemer Emerge, Andrew Brown from Face to Face. Ian Duke, you had an eye on that one. What happened with that?
Yeah, it was a great back-and-forth game, a lot of very complicated board states, a lot of Emrakuls, but in the end, it was Sam Pardee that came out on top in that match.
Mm-hmm. That was a 3-1 win for Pardee, and our last quarterfinals saw Lukas Blohon of the Czech Republic with white-black control against the red-green ramp deck of Ken Yukihiro, who had given us such splendid entertainment coming in to the top eight. Well, this one went the distance. It went the full five games, but when the dust settled, Lukas Blohon advanced to the semifinals. And BDM, before the quarterfinals began, you had the intel that that was exactly how that was meant to pan out. 0-2 pre-sideboard, 3-0 post-sideboard.
Yeah, I was talking to Martin Yuzer, who was helping Lukas playtest, and he just had never seen such a lopsided pre-sideboarding, post-sideboarding matchup, and felt that despite the fact that he didn't think it was possible to win either of those first two games, that they might even be advantaged in the matchup after sideboarding, which is kind of crazy and really, really an unusual thing for us to see.
Yeah, I totally agree. I was in the booth at the time, and you know, often when people talk about one deck or the other being favored, we're talking about 55-45, 60-40. So even, you know, when the prediction, as it were, is 0-2, pre-sideboard and then, you know, 3-0 post-sideboard, chances are that's still going to get mixed up a little bit through variance. But no, it played out exactly like that. And honestly, it was a true delight to watch Lukas Blohon navigate that matchup and just pick apart Ken Yukihiro's deck.
Yeah, make no mistake, Lukas Blohon's really, really good at Magic. We go into the semifinals then, and our opener was Lewis Scott Vargas down at the bottom there, the last remaining Bant Company deck against Teemer Emerge for Owen Turtenweld. And this one, again, tremendous back and forth BDM, 1-0, 1-1, 2-1, 2-2. Owen was never ahead in that match until when it absolutely mattered, 3-2, Owen Turtenweld advanced.
Yeah, absolutely. I can't remember the last time we had this titanic a matchup on the stage here. And of course, it went the full five games. I looked for a minute like maybe Owen was going to run over Luis when Luis stumbled on mana coming out of the gate, but you see why he's such a great player. He put himself in a position to, you know, a couple times to possibly steal that game away. It would have been one of the great comeback wins in terms of like his position in that game. But Owen just, you know, head down and pulled out there to win and advance to the finals, the first finals of his Pro Tour career. At the Pro Tour.
Mm-hmm. So then we had semifinal number two. It was the top seed, Sam Pardee, with black-green Delirium against Lukas Blohon with his white-black control in. It's just finished. How did it turn out?
Lukas Blohon ended up getting the upper hand there, winning that match 3-0. That third game was actually looking a little bit close, but he was able to stabilize, turn things around, and take the win there.
Yeah, so we must say congratulations at that point to Sam Pardee, your number one seed, a real breakthrough for him. He was the only competitor in this top eight, this almost never happens, the only player in the top eight for whom this was the first go-round on Sunday. And that's just, he acquitted himself beautifully, and I'm sure he'll be all the better for the experience.
Yeah, Sam Pardee, someone who's had a lot of success at the Grand Prix circuit, a couple Grand Prix wins. Mm-hmm. And in fact, it was kind of just an interesting piece of trivia about this top eight. Every single member of the top eight had a Grand Prix trophy coming into this weekend.
Yeah, that's pretty beautiful. Everyone has already been in the winner's circle. Someone is going to be in the winner's circle again, probably a couple of hours from now. We're about 10 minutes away from the start of our best 3 out of 5 final between Owen Turtenweld and Lukas Blohon. Now, I'm going to try quite hard not to talk about Owen Turtenweld for the next few minutes, and I think it's going to be impossible because it's time to talk about the World Championship competitors. 24 seats were available. Some of those were already known coming into the event. We're going to take a look for you and run you through the field for the 2016 World Championship. So here we go, and our initial group of players here, mostly these were already known coming into the weekend. So we kick off with Seth Manfield. He was the first player in because he won the 2015 Magic World Championship. He is also in on top pro points for North America, so that creates an at-large spot. Owen Turtenweld is already, yeah, see, there we are, it didn't take long, did it? Mid-season master, 2015-16 player of the year, and top pro points in North America, so he gobbles up three slots already.
Worth noting, those two players faced each other in the finals of the last World Championship, and it was one of the great matches that we've had a chance to watch.
It's also worth mentioning, coming into the tournament, Seth Manfield had such a tremendous lead in the Player of the Year race. Rich, I believe you described it as a one-horse race, actually, even
pretty
earlier
close.
In this tournament.
It was.
You know, things lined up in the perfect way for Owen Turtenweld, actually, to make the top eight. Seth, you know, didn't do as well as he needed to, and Owen actually surpassed him.
Bottom line, it was a one-horse race. It just turns out Owen Turtenweld's a machine. There we go. So moving on down the list. Now, you're looking at a gap there because we've got Niels Norlander, the Magic Online champion, and then it is our Pro Tour champions from this season. So Kazuyuki Takamura of Japan, two Americans, Jay Chen Tao and Steve Rubin. We will add one more name there, and we could add a fourth slot to Owen Turtenweld because he would be the Pro Tour Eldritch Moon champion if he can get past Lukas Blohon. So an absolutely astonishing crowd there. And Brian, just before we go by, BDM, you should talk about BBD.
Well, yeah, you know, Brian Bronduin is won the Pro Points lead in Grand Prix for the year. And you know, it happened last weekend at Grand Prix Sydney. And you know, again, we had a little bit of drama because he was out ahead and Seth Manfield came in and managed to make the top eight. And if Seth Manfield had won that, he could have taken that title away from him. But Brian Bronduin did well enough at that event and was able to, travel the world and win a Grand Prix in South America and fly all over the place, that he's going to be playing in Worlds this year.
So that's seven of our 24, and we're waiting for the eighth, which is that slot, the Pro Tour Eldritch Moon champion. Let's move on and take a look at our next group of players who are in. And Ian, two great races that really culminated this weekend, the Draftmaster and Constructed Master. Congratulations, Marcio Carvalho and Oliver too.
Yeah, those were fantastic to watch unfold here this weekend. A bit of drama as we went through, players neck and neck with each other. I know we watched Christian Calcano and Marcio Carvalho both in the feature match area, both live for Draftmaster at the same time. Of course, it was Marcio Carvalho who ended up on top there, but that was fantastic to watch unfold.
And Brian, Oliver too, not just the Constructed Master, it doesn't come with a slot at Worlds, but Rookie of the Year by cataclysmic margins over the field.
I mean, he's platinum this season. So, I mean, it just tells you what kind of season he has. You don't usually see someone win the Rookie of the Year title with that level of success. And in fact, know that they're going to be able to play on the Pro Tour, the following year with that same kind of, ability to be qualified throughout the whole year. And he's just been tremendous. Four Pro Tours under his belt. Just was the best constructed player on the Pro Tour for an entire season. That's the dream. That's like playing Magic with your buddies at the local store, and you're like, one day I'm going to go to the Pro Tour and I'm going to be the best player in constructed. I know how to do this. When you're just talking smack with your friends, right? You're like, I'm going to go to the Pro Tour. I'm going to show them how it's done. And he went, got qualified for the first Pro Tour, and just put up tremendous results all the way through the season.
So Luis Scott Vargas is your outstanding Hall of Famer. He's also in the North American slot. And we start looking at the regions then. If we go back, two Latin American slots, they went to Paolo Vida, Dama de Rosa, and Thiago Saporito, as we expected them to coming in. They had big leads. And then the three Europeans, well, Joel Larsson, three pro top 16 finishes at the Pro Tour this season. Martin Muller, the Danish Dane Blast player, of course.
Also ending on a top 16 this season.
Right. And then, of course, we have Lukas Blohon, who is the top European player, regardless of what happens here in the final. He, of course, could eat up another slot by being the Pro Tour Eldritch Moon champion. So let's move on and take a look at our final set of players who are in the World Championship. Now, you can see up at the top there, Ian, you're thinking, well, that's a bit of a puzzle. What is this top pro points in North America or at large for Reed Duke? Well, I can tell you now that because Sam Pardee lost his semi-final, that means that Sam Pardee down the bottom there is an at large, and it means that Reed Duke does claim one of the North American slots. Now, Reed wasn't sweating. He knew he was into Worlds either way, but it is as a representative of North America. Also in for Pro Points on North America is Brad Nelson. And then BDM, what about the Asia Pacific?
So there we have, Shota Yasuoka, who was in the mix for Outstanding Hall of Famer as well. Mm-hmm. And Ryuichi Tamada, our finalist from Pro Tour Battle for Zendikar.
Right, and then a really huge one. Randy and I talked about this at the very start of Friday morning. What a big weekend in it was going to be for Yuya Watanabe, because he was on 51 pro points, elected into the Magic the Gathering Pro Tour Hall of Fame, but not certain at all of a slot at Worlds. And really, we've seen such great performances from him over the years. Worlds would be a poorer place without him. Really glad to see him there.
Yeah, totally agree. And he was just quietly battling all throughout the tournament, hoping to solidify that slot.
And I know that you're going to be at PAX as well. You're going to be part of the team there?
Absolutely, yeah. The World Championship will be held in Seattle later, at the end of this month or beginning of next month at PAX. And I'll be there doing coverage. It's going to be fantastic to watch.
It really is. You're going to get 5 days of epic stuff, and not just the World Championship, because it's our unveiling of Kaladesh as we head into the new term, if you like, the new season. There'll be another Pro Tour along, Pro Tour Kaladesh, and Kaladesh, new set coming along. It's going to be great. Tons of amazing content as we unveil that set for you over the course of 5 great days at the World Championship. But let's get back to our last few players who are in. This is the at-large selection. And the last four names there, well, we've got two North Americans and two Europeans. So we've got Andre Straske and Andrea Mengucci. BDM, Andrea Mengucci, 1-5 on day one, miserable, asking about tie breaks on day two, checking about 15 people every round for their results. But in the end, 23rd place, if you will, at large, he's in, and he's another terrific addition, particularly in terms of personality, because he's great to have around.
Absolutely, larger than life. We saw him make the top eight at our last Pro Tour. We also saw him win the World Magic Cup as a member of Team Italy.
And our last player into the World Championship, now that we know there's only one match left in the 2015-16 season, is Player of the Year, Mike Sigrist. He will be back at Worlds. Congratulations to him. Congratulations to all 24 players going to the World Championship. Two of them are about to play that last match of the 2015-16 season. Let's take a look at them. Here comes the final. We begin with Owen Turtenwild, your new Player of the Year. And he has just had a magnificent season. There he is, so much to smile about. Four Grand Prix titles, twice Player of the Year now. Not a long list of people have done that. And he is playing Teamer Emerge. Let's take a look at his deck list for you. And Ian, give us a sense of what we should be looking for here in the final out of this Teamer Emerge deck.
So yeah, again, we've seen a little bit of this deck before. To recap, it's got a couple different things going on. It's a Delirium deck. It's seeking to fill its graveyard and use cards like Grapple with the Past, Vessel of Nascency to get value out of the graveyard, as well as stock it up. Its high end culminates, of course, in Emrakul, a card we've seen throughout the weekend. Very, very powerful end game. And then it also has this sort of mid-game package of Elder Deep Fiend with Kozilek's Return, which is good at sort of controlling the mid-game and adding some trickery to its repertoire.
And BDM, worth mentioning that Emrakul is a card that some people have just played one of, thinking that one is sufficient, he may be bringing it back. Owen's with three in the main deck because he knows that sometimes one Emrakul isn't enough.
Yeah, this really was the plan for Pantheon coming in. It was like, this is the card they wanted to play, and you know, you want to make sure you can cast it, mm-hmm. but then you also need to make sure you can draw it.
Right. So let's head across to Owen's opponent here in the final. It is Lukas Blohon of the Czech Republic from the cabin crew, 236 lifetime pro points. He has a chance to go from 65,000 to 105,000 in the next hour or so. And then you've got two Pro Tour top eights to him. He is a Grand Prix winner this season. Brussels in a European murderer's row. It was a phenomenal Grand Prix, that one, for him to win. And a precursor of just a tremendous season that included the World Magic Cup captaincy for the Czech Republic. Let's take a look at his deck list for you. If you haven't been with us, just getting home from a day out with the family, welcome along on Sunday evening or Sunday morning, wherever you are around the world. Here is his white-black control deck that he's going to battle with. BDM, this is sort of headlined right up top. 3-2-1, 3 Liliana the Last Hope, 2 Obnixilis Reignited, and a Sorin Grim Nemesis, the Planeswalker package.
We saw them all in play at the same time, along with a transformed Avacyn in his last match in the semifinals. Really showed off the power of his deck, and it can really give, you know, where everyone is thinking, came into this event thinking about bad company and dealing with creatures, a board full of planeswalkers can be really challenging for a lot of decks to deal with.
Mm-hmm. Ian, I'm afraid it's time. Give me a winner. Luke Blohon or Turtenwild?
I'm going to go with Turtenwild here.
BDM?
I think it's Owen Turtenwild.
Are we about to see one of the most amazing culminations to a season ever in the history of Magic the Gathering? Let's find out. It's time for the final of Pro Tour Eldritch Moon.